So thanks for coming here to managing your online reputation. I was excited of the placement because what Eric was talking about, if you're in his session before, he's talking about social media. And I talk about social media. I help people with social media. I'm a big fan, but it's getting harder and harder to go out there and update Facebook pages because people are kind of ridiculous sometimes. So I want to talk a little bit about, your online reputation. So first, I want to talk about me just for a minute. I've been a web designer since 98. I worked a full-time job and I kind of built this up on the side. Quit my job about 15 years ago and I just been building websites. It's really fun. I love not working for the man and being able to make a living doing this. So I've got about 400 clients that luckily everybody doesn't want to talk to me at once. So there's been people that I haven't talked to in probably 5 years. But they're still my clients, so it's nice. But again, I manage social media for clients, usually Facebook pages. I try to help people. I do small free workshops on getting people into using Facebook. And I'm involved in a WordPress community for about 5 years now. I love it. I love WordPress. I used to build all my sites in HTML until about 5 years ago. I went kicking and screaming to WordPress. And it's so wonderful because everybody can update their own site now. And I don't have to deal with that a little bit. So that's about me. From Peoria, I try to get involved in the WordPress community and I try to do some free WordPress workshops too, just around Peoria, just to kind of get people involved. I want them to know how easy it is. So anyway, let's get on here to this reputation. Owning a small business is wonderful and we have a little storefront. So I like when people can just pop in. We get a lot of foot traffic because we're next to a busy restaurant. So people just stop in and they want to know about either computer repair or, web design. But we really like having that storefront. And I always think about how people look at small businesses. When they're talking about their online reputation, they want to see what kind of location they have. I feel like these are some of the things that people look at. Are they good at their job? How long have they been in business? Are they going to pack up and leave, after I start doing business with them? So that's the business part. But then when people come in our store, they're also looking at, are they friendly? Are they going to even talk to me? I know some businesses where you have to have an appointment before you can talk to someone, even just to go in and ask them a question. So, I feel like that's a good fit. When people are looking for businesses or people to do business with, they're kind of looking at those type of things. Are they friendly? Sometimes people aren't a good fit. And, I try to be that way. I try to be a good fit for everyone, but I've met with clients before where I just knew it wasn't going to work out. And, they kind of knew it too. So it's good to be honest up front. And anyway, there's my soapbox. When you're talking on social media, when you're conveying yourself, this kind of goes, okay, you've got the storefront, but now you're expanding out and you're online. And I'm not talking about just your business pages. And just your business Facebook page. I'm talking about your personal page too. People do go and look before they do business with you, before they rent to you, even before they're going to do a partnership, they do their little background check and go out and Google your name. Maybe they go out on Facebook and Google you, or Facebook and search for you. They want to see who they're doing business with. So let me give you an example, okay? I've got a little rental house. I've had this house for a long time. It's just a really tiny one-bedroom house. I needed to rent it, and this girl called me. She's really nice, moving down from Wisconsin. I'm in Peoria, Illinois, and she sounded really great on the phone. I got off the phone. I told my husband, hey, I think we got our renter. Here she is. He said, did you look her up on Facebook? I go, no. So I did. And then I found this girl who, it wasn't just the cannabis cans that bothered me. It was her post. Too many Jaegers the night before. I'm calling into work today. This is the stuff that she posted on her personal page. And you can see I'm not friends with her, but I could see everything that she was posting. Saw a lot of pictures. One was her laying passed out in a bathtub. And, you know, nobody's going to hire her. She's not going to be able to get a job if you have a Facebook page like that. So I passed, you know, on her. I told her that the place was already rented. I was trying to be nice. And I really wanted to be the mom and say, look, you need to clean that up, you know. You're not going to get a job with stuff like this. And not just that, but tech people, too. You know, we're all tweeting and we're all talking fast and we're trying to get our work message out. This guy, he worked at Oracle, which is a big tech company, and he's bragging about not working. But the point I want to make on this is from 2007. So this stuff kind of stays out there. You know, you want to make a point. I mean, I'm not trying to tell you what to do. I'm just making suggestions that people do go out and look for you online. So, you know, it's easy to get it cleaned up, but sometimes once you say stuff, it stays out there. You guys are all witnesses to mistakes, to problems. If you've been on social media at all, you've seen a lot of that, I'm sure, or you've seen stories about it. So I'm trying to tell people, look, you know, it's easy to get a good online presence without getting sucked into the drama. So what I like to do, if I go out and search for your name, these are just some of the things that I feel like people should have. One is you should have a website, but also you should own your own domain name. So I own tammyfinch.com. My daughter owns Ashley Mungie. She just got married last year, so I bought her a new domain name with her name. And I feel like everybody should own their own domain name, your name, because now you own it. You own that little piece of internet. Somebody's searching for you. You can put whatever you want on it, but you don't have to worry about being confused with other people. So for example, I was looking up my vet. I was just looking for his phone number. I don't know where my phone book is, so I Googled it. Jason Brown Animals. And it was about this guy that abused animals, and he was going to prison for it. And so I know that wasn't my vet, but, you know, that's how people are looking. And I know it wasn't him, but I really wish he would have had a little bit more of a presence, an online presence. Because when I would have searched Jason Brown Animals, maybe his website would have come up. So when you're out, these are some of the things that I feel like people need. Social media accounts. Have your name or your business name attached to those. Have you written any positive reviews? I'm going to talk about reviews a little bit later, but people are so quick to go in and complain. But what about some positive things? That helps some small businesses. Don't you get good coffee at the coffee shop? Have you had some good pie somewhere? You know, tell some people about that. You've had good service somewhere. Let people know about that. And somebody's searching finally, maybe your business name. You know, if I'm doing a search for your name, I would like all of that stuff to come up. There's some resources you can use. Google Alerts is free. You can put in some keywords here, and then you'll get fed every day an email when all of those keywords are posted. So I like to search for my name, my company name. But I also, my friend is a speaker, and she likes to search for call for presenters. So then she gets fed all of these places that are looking for presenters. Google Plus is a nice program to, you know, get connected to. Google likes Google. So when people are searching, you know, hopefully that's coming up. And when I was in Seattle, somebody talked about mention.com, which is real time. They're searching everywhere, not just the internet. I mean, all of the social media accounts, all of the networks, they're searching for certain names. It's $30 a month, but, you know, I like free, so that's why I use Google Alerts.
What's the name
of it? It's called mention.com. Yeah, $30 a month. If you're a professional and you're really worried about your online presence, I think it's a good investment. And if you work for a company, you know, it might be a good investment, but Google Alerts kind of does the same thing. It's just, the point is, I want people to just kind of keep track of what's being said about you. So we talked about Chris Lemma. I love Chris Lemma. I read his blog all the time. I think he's great. In fact, I was in Seattle doing the same presentation, and I was talking about him on the slide, and I didn't realize he was in the audience. I would have been so nervous if I would have known it, but he did this presentation at WordCamp in San Francisco, and he talks about a brand is what we say it is. When he says we, he meant the internet. And it's because, in this case, he was talking about Nike, talking about their shoes and how great they were. They have these new shoes they were putting out. But people don't care about what Nike's saying. They care about what their friends say or what the reviews are saying. You know, that's what people are going to look at. And whatever those people are talking about is what people are going to believe. Does that make sense to everybody? All right, I got some head nods, so that's good.
It depends.
Well, and again.
Because I moderate a website that is related to food and culture, mm-hmm. and it's sort of the Siskel Ebert thing.
Sure.
If you agree with Siskel, you know, you kind of probably go along with that person. But if you disagree with Siskel, you know, then you know whether or not that person's reliable.
Well, and a lot of times people are looking, and I'll talk about reviews in a little bit. A lot of times people do look at negative reviews to see what the big deal is. You know, when I go to hotels, I look at the negative reviews because if it's something like noisy neighbors, I'm probably not going to have to deal with that. Or if they say they needed renovations, hopefully the hotel says, hey, we've already started that, and this was like 5 years ago. So, you know, it's something that's valuable. Even a bad review is valuable. So a couple of things, you know, you can look at your business and see what's going on there. Google yourself, check in, look at some check-ins. If somebody's checking into your company, go look at that. We work with a restaurant, and I like to look at those check-ins because I want to see if people are complaining about the wait staff or they're bragging about the pizza. So, you know, look and see what your customers are saying about you, too, and also your employees. Have some policies in place for them. Some of the things that people need to worry about is what your employees are saying about you online and if that's affecting your brand. So let's get into that a tiny bit with this little teacher comment. You know, she's waiting for summer, and she's saying, I already want to stab some kids. Is that bad? 19 more days. Counting down to summer. But she didn't get in trouble for this because there weren't any policies. She can just say whatever she wants to. Unfortunately, now this tweet is attached to the school where she worked at. So, you know, how your employees are talking is kind of how it's going to be a reflection on your business, too. So have some policies in place. Talk to your employees and tell them, you know, don't badmouth me. If you don't like your job here, then go find another job. But I don't think that that's really a problem too much. But, you know, sometimes there are people that aren't happy with their job. A main thing, too, is to keep 100% control over your social media. Don't let people take over. You see that a lot. People go on tangents and stuff like that. Also have a backup administrator. I can't tell you how many Facebook pages I've tried to take over for people who the page was set up by someone else, the employee got mad and left, and now they have to start all over again. So make sure you have two administrators on those pages or on your social media. And there's a website. I try to send people, I work with some medical groups, social media governance, and they have a lot of policies that you can just download and then you can modify them for yourself. So it's kind of nice to see what other people are doing. You know, it's got Mayo Clinic and Cleveland Clinic there. You can go take a look at those if you want to get started on that. So I always get sick to my stomach when people talk about well, Tammy, we got this intern and they know a lot about social media, so, you know, we're going to let them take over. And the problem is, and not to say anything bad about interns, it's just that they don't have, a lot of times they don't have the business voice, or they're in such a hurry that they don't switch accounts before they post, you know, something bad about someone. And so there's a bad mistake here. Somebody's talking about President or former President Obama, very bad tweet, and then KitchenAid has to come back and make this apology. The other tweet was retweeted way more times than the apology was. So, you know, have control over it. Make sure you know what people are posting. If you have a social media manager, make them give you some examples of what they're going to be posting. So just a sample, there's thousands of examples and people keep sending them to me all the time, but again, people are tweeting, they're getting carried away. They really need to slow down, but most of these samples, the bad samples, are interns who, you know, just getting carried away there. If you're just starting out, a good place to start is your website. Go get it optimized. You know, everybody's talking about Yoast plugin. It's a good way to optimize your website. Be visible on some industry sites too. If you want to get involved in the WordPress community, go get involved in some of the groups. There's lots of WordPress groups. If you want to establish yourself and say, look, I'm part of WordPress. Best thing to do is get involved in some groups. You know, be visible, talk about WordPress. Be active on social media, check your local directories. If you have a standalone company, it's nice to make sure that your company is listed on some of these local directories. I'm gonna just fly through these. And poor Mr. Cosby, his social media manager had this great idea of putting pictures of him, and everybody could create their own meme of Mr. Cosby. And I saw it coming. In the morning, they were announcing it, and I thought, no, why are you doing that? And unfortunately, he was, you know, there was all this publicity about, everybody knows the story, I think. And at first it was fun. You know, it started off with, you know, fatherhood, and then, you know, some quotes that he had done. Then it just got ugly. And this is a good example of turning your social media over to someone else. When you give it to the internet, you don't know what you're gonna get. And this was bad, but there's so many of these memes now out here that there's no way they can rein them in. They just can't get rid of them. So it's unfortunate that somebody had that bright idea, but people said, well, Tammy, what would you have done? And I said, well, I would have created them myself and then let people share them. That's how you keep control over that. Just, you can't turn it over. The internet, everybody's, their decisions are questionable. They have this huge boat in I think it's in Britain, that somebody named Bodie McBoatface because they let the internet name it. You know? And the government said, we're not naming it Bodie McBoatface. So everybody's mad because they said, well, they were voted. It was like 78% of the vote. And so they said that it would be a nickname for the boat because they were worried if the boat was in trouble, they couldn't say, you know, Mayday, Bodie McBoatface, you know. So, but that's what happens. You know, you turn it over to the internet and you get that. That's the kind of decisions, which they're fun. You know, everybody, I mean, people have just such great sense of humor. But if it's your presence or your brand, you don't want to give that over to someone else. So our zoo in Peoria, last year we had a little giraffe was born, this baby giraffe. And he was so cute. He was running around. They had a lot of video of him. And everybody was, you know, following the page because they liked this little giraffe. He was really cute. So then they said, okay, we're going to let Facebook name the giraffe. And I thought, no, don't do that. And they said, we have three names, and everybody gets to vote on the name. I said, oh, yay, that's great. That's the perfect thing to do. You know, you're controlling the data, you're controlling what the name's going to be, and then everybody got to vote. So they still got to participate, but, you know, you still kept control over that. And one of the comments was, oh, darn, I would have named him Stretchy McNecky. Now, that's what you would have got if you would have let people name your giraffe. So, but people are fun. So your professional cleanup, you know, this is easy to do. I mean, go in and start claiming some local pages. And I mean local like Yelp, Dex. You know, start claiming those because then you have control over them. And you also get to keep track of what people are saying about you. Ask for reviews. I don't know why people don't, you know, it doesn't hurt to ask for that. Whenever you do a follow-up with someone, you sell them something, and then you send a thank you follow-up letter, why not say, hey, if you've had a good relationship or a good experience with us, please write a nice review for us. So I don't feel like that's a bad thing. It's just kind of reminding people that, you know, show your support, be a good customer. If you have bad reviews, though, I work with a coffee shop, and they had just opened, and this guy came in and just wrote this scathing review on TripAdvisor for no reason. You know, they just opened, the coffee was good, but the guy wanted to open a coffee shop in town, and, you know, there's all this drama. So he wrote this bad review. And I was talking to Fred at the coffee shop, and he was, what do I do? I said, well, you know, you can't do anything. I mean, you can go and tell your side and say, you know, I'm really sorry you had that experience, but if you come in, I'll give you a free cup of coffee. He goes, I'm not giving him anything. So I said, well, the best thing to do, maybe ask some of your other customers to write something nice. And he goes, well, how? I said, well, put something in the coffee shop. So we put, because this was on TripAdvisor, we put the little TripAdvisor logo on his door, just as a reminder that people could go there. And now he has like 56, 60 good five-star reviews, and then this other one's buried. So sometimes that's all you can do. You know, people are silly, but getting the good reviews, I think, is just a nice thing that I think more people should do. Now, let's talk about reviews very quickly. There's a plugin that I use. 800,000 active installs. Look at how many reviews that people wrote on that. That's just a shame. These people are writing these plugins for us for free. We don't have to pay anything for these. And then we can't do a couple of clicks and, you know, give them a nice rating. But, you know, a lot of people like me, before I install a plugin or if I'm investigating plugins, I go and look at these reviews. That's how I base how it works. You know, I'm asking the community. I can go and look at their website and say, oh yeah, they say it's good, but really this is how people are shopping now. So for the plugin developers, please give them something nice. You know, be a good customer.
Is the name of your plugin what's Yext?
Yext is, these are like review programs. So you could use Yext, single platform. There are places where you can track reviews. So you can use Yext and set up all of your accounts on like YP, Yelp, they use Google Local, Bing Local, and then you can keep track. If somebody's writing a review, you'll get an email that says what it says. And then you can go out and respond to it. People don't respond like they should, and I'm guilty of it too. But if somebody writes a nice review on Facebook, I do go and like it, or I comment or something, but you really have to keep track of what's being said about you. If somebody does have a bad experience, you know, you need to know about it. Let me give you another example. A CPA in Chicago, I work with him. I was looking up his phone number, and I Google it because, you know, I don't know where my phone book is. So Googled it, and on Google, he had like 3 or 4 really bad reviews. So when I called him, I was reading them to him, and he was just mortified. He said, I know that lady. She's one of my good customers. I feel terrible. And this lady named names. The employees were late for meetings. They were rude to her when she called. They were late getting her taxes done. And he went to his employees and said, you know, what happened? And they said, oh yeah, we hate working with her. Yeah, we're rude to her because we don't like her. She's always mean and, you know, she's real demanding. And he was so embarrassed, but he would have never known that his customers were getting that kind of service if it wasn't for the review. So he ended up firing everybody.
Great.
Yeah. And he should have. I mean, that's your company. You know, you work hard for that. And then somebody's going to demolish it just by being rude to your customers. So that's why people should pay attention to what's being said about them online. Even if it's bad, I mean, that's really feedback is all you're getting. Does everybody agree with me?
Yeah.
Okay, but let's talk about the feedback. Because we don't want to fight with people. We don't want to argue. Sometimes people do like to do that, and then it just ends up bad. You're not going to want to fight because people want to get involved in it. And, you know, you really don't need to do that. Also, don't lie. Don't argue with people. If you lie, somebody's going to call you out because it's easy to Google things. And, you know, this happens to a lot of athletes. I see it happen to celebrities. Oh, I didn't do that. And then somebody comes out with a video that shows that they did. You know, don't lie. Just be upfront and just say, look, I'm really sorry that this happened to you. Let me make it up to you. And customer service really goes a long way, even online. I don't think that that people should have to fight for that, for their customers. Just be good. Set up monitoring. If there is something bad, like our CPA, he didn't know what to do, I said, go on Google and apologize to this woman and say that you didn't know that this was happening. And then he did. And, you know, he took her to lunch and he apologized. She's still his customer. But he did tell his side and he told it nicely. He didn't fight or argue or anything like that. And again, give some good reviews. How many people in here, just raise your hand quick, has had a great dinner, great experience, a great support from another company? Anybody? Just half? Okay, that's good. So all of you guys, just go home and write something nice about that company. And then if you can try to get in the habit of doing that, I mean, there's all these places where you can do it. You can do it on Google, on Facebook, on Yelp, any of those review sites. So I'm on a mission to try to, you know, be a good customer and write good reviews for companies like that. To make it easy for the lazy internet users, and I build websites for a living, so I know how it is. You know, people have to be directed. They want to get there quickly, and they want the site to load fast, which is, you know, that's fine. But also, we started creating these feedback forms because people, sometimes they don't know where to go to write a nice review on Google or write a review on Facebook. So we put links on the feedback form up at the top there. And then if they do want to just give something private, they have a little contact form where they can, you know, just fill that out. We started putting that on some websites where people, you know, they actually want to get feedback or testimonials. So something simple to do, but it's a good way to kind of keep track of what people are saying. So managing your reputation, you don't want to be a jerk about it. You want to be nice. I know sometimes clients are hard to deal with, and sometimes they just get bent out of shape. I always like take a step back and say, okay, I'm gonna wait before I answer this email. And you don't want to, you know, just jump in with both feet. You want to take a step back. Some things, though, and we're talking about Chris Lemma. When I saw him in Seattle, he was talking about how he blogged every day. He wrote a blog post for a year. It might have been 3 years, but I'm thinking that it wasn't. But that's a lot of blog. I mean, that's commitment. He told a story every time, and he's a good storyteller. He's a good speaker, too, but when he's speaking, he's telling stories. People can relate to that. And I think that's why he's popular, you know, because people, oh, yeah, I've done that, or, oh, that's happened to me before, too. also be who you say you are. And there's so many times where people, you know, that transparency is so important to other clients. If you have, and I think that's why testimonials and reviews are so popular, because people want to see. They want to know what their friends think of you or their family. If you can be a resource to, you know, educating people on what you do and things that they can do to grow their business, now you're the resource. And they're going to come to you when they have questions and, you know, or need advice. Then you can charge them. So adding, just having a blog site or something like that, even like a newsletter, just giving people tips, it's a good way to connect with people. Any questions about anybody? Everybody's so quiet.
What if you have that client that kind of puts their head in the sand when they get negative stuff that happened to them?
Oh, I know.
And they do nothing.
I know.
They freak out and then they do nothing.
I know. And, you know, maybe if you could tell them a story about how a negative review can turn around. Because really, I don't think negative reviews are bad. Because people are in the habit of seeing what people are complaining about. And if it's something stupid, they just blow it off. But also, you want to see, you know, are your employees being rude? Or, you know, did something happen in the store that you need to know about? It's just part of the responsibility of being a business owner. So I feel like they should at least respond to them and say, look, I'm sorry you had a bad experience with us. Hopefully we can do better next time. You don't have to offer them something free, you know, just at least you're listening to them. So maybe you can put it that way, you know, just at least you're listening to your customers.
Yeah, I think inherently bad reviews should become an essential part of good reviews.
Oh, sure.
There's got to be some bad reviews. When I look at any, if it's a product or a service, I look at the bad reviews, mm-hmm. the negative reviews.
Yeah.
But I look at that in ratio of, you can look at all good reviews.
Right.
An entity that's got only good reviews, I go,
Exactly.
That's what I do.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, sounds too good to be true.
Sure.
Then I pedal back. I said, I need to do it more deeply.
Right. And, you know, you're just doing your research before you're purchasing anything. And, you know, it's important to have, even on your own website, if you have products, why not let people review those? Google ranks those types of websites where you have internal reviews. They rank those a little bit higher anyway. So I think if somebody has a shopping cart, they should open those up. A lot of times they close down reviews. They don't want people to put them on their own website. So I think they should. All right, so when you're moving forward, don't freak out about the reviews. Like we said, we think that, you know, good and bad reviews are good. So start where you're at. Spend an hour a week on your online reputation, and that means getting your website cleaned up, getting your social media cleaned up. Sometimes you do have to delete some pictures. Sometimes you have to unfollow people. Sometimes you do have to unfriend people. Because think about it, when you're friending people, now you're associated with them. If you're a fan of someone's Facebook page, now you're a fan of their company. So is that the type of person you want to be associated with, or the type of company? Go and look. You know, I feel like that's why people need to have control over their social media, because if they don't, somebody else is putting stuff out there and you might not even agree with it. Go try to own that first page of Google. It's easy, and people say, oh yeah, I want to be on the first page of Google. You can be. You have a nice optimized website. Are you writing articles? Are you blogging? Are you putting blogs on LinkedIn? Are you blogging on your own website? You know, you're going to get ranked when the more things you have out there, the more things that are indexed in Google. So being a blogger, you don't have to blog every single day like Chris Lama did, but how about once a month? You know, and then you can reuse that on social media and stuff. Go out once a week and write a nice review for a company. You know, praise their services or if you have good products, if there's just something that you like, you know, go out and do that. I think that that's, it's important really to small businesses too, because people are looking at it. And then don't forget about your employees. Just sit down and talk to them and say, look, you know, if you're going to mention my company, you have to, you know, just be nice. I mean, if you don't like your job, it doesn't hurt to go out and look and see what they're posting about. Unfortunately, somebody in my family was constantly complaining on his Facebook page about his job. And I said, you know, when you get fired from that job for talking that way, nobody's going to hire you because they don't want you talking about their company that way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's just something to think about because people do go look at your personal accounts. So then what do you do? I'm going to read you my little, here's me. I'm trying to be a good customer. I wrote this 5-star review talking about the potato Olays. They're wonderful. I'm a picky type person. I don't like a lot of stuff on my food, and it's true. I don't like my food to touch, and I have all these food rules. And I said, I asked for a special order, got exactly what I wanted. Nice, friendly people, too. Thanks, everyone. And then this guy comes along, like, 3 years later, and he puts on my review of this company, Tammy is my mother, and she's lying to you. She's always been a liar ever since I met her in 2006. Why did you cheat on Dad like that, Tammy? You broke his damn heart. And I was like, who's that? Who's that guy? I don't have a son. I have 2 daughters. But he, you know, he followed me around. I don't know who he was, but he was from our area. He's just trying to be funny. And he followed me around and wrote, you know, stuff about me cheating on his dad and
on other websites?
Yeah, on other Google reviews that I So I did this review on Google and I found this one and then I saw another one where he had done the same thing. So I sent him a message. You know, a lot of times I've had good luck with getting bad reviews taken off of Yahoo and for clients, you know, you can file a grievance with the website. But this guy, since it was Google, I just messaged him. I'm like, Bryce, what are you doing? Why are you associating me with a cheater? So he just put a smile face and then he went and deleted his reviews. So sometimes though, if you do have to deal with people like that, I mean, he could have been mean and just left it up there. Then I would have probably filed a grievance with Google and said, you know, what's he doing? Sometimes people are mean and they don't let things go. And then I feel like you have to take the high road and just ignore them. That's unfortunate, but you know, it happens. So anyway, poor Bryce. So those were just some of my stories. I got another one, but I'm running out of time. And I did want to mention, you know, stuff about some of the clients that have to deal with things. And, you know, there's always workarounds. And you can always, I feel like dealing with it head on and just talking to your employees if that's what it's about. Or, you know, just burying reviews, it still works. So any questions for me? I got a few minutes. Yeah. Oh, I know.
I've talked to some past Yelp employees, and they said they do things like if the user hasn't given so many reviews, then it gets flagged and it doesn't go on there. If it's a brand new user account, it gets flagged. Or if you get more than one review that day, then neither of them will go on there. And I'm wondering, have you had any issues with building up reputation on Yelp? And if so, do you have any tips or tricks or things to kind of help that problem?
Well, you know, I deal with this restaurant, like I said, and they have 5 locations. They have either 5-star review on Yelp or a 1-star review on Yelp. And Yelp, if you have an account, you can go in. If you own the listing, you can go in and make comments on the actual reviews. But what I've noticed is if you pay and if you're advertising on Yelp, it seems like your 5-star reviews are higher than your one-star reviews, no matter what the date is on them.
Well, we had a client that was paying, and he still had the bad reviews on there, and he actually quit paying, because he said, why would I drive people to a site that has bad reviews? And then you see on the bottom, it would say something like, the previous or the below reviews are not being shown because they're flagged. And they were actually legitimate reviews from clients that have left them on there, but they didn't meet the criteria of what Yelp was saying.
Yeah.
And so people have really hated them because of that, because they can't even get real reviews on there.
I know. And you know what? I don't know why Yelp can get away with that, because there's a lot of fake ones on there too. And I know that people have complained many times about Yelp, but you know, I don't know. I don't know what to do about it. They do have reps where you can contact them and talk to them, but they're usually trying to sell you something. Right.
Makes sense. And I mean, I don't know a lot of people that use Yelp. So when you say, hey, go give me a Yelp review, they usually have to sign up for a new account to give it, and then it doesn't even stick. So it's like
right.
kind of a waste of your time to even try to build that up, because it's not going to stick.
So yeah. And there's, you know, there's better ways to build up reviews. I don't like Yelp either. And, you know, I say it publicly, just because they're hard to work with. Google and Yahoo have been just wonderful. I mean, If you can file a grievance with them and get things taken off, if they think that somebody had done it maliciously or they think it's a competitor. And, you know, we're dealing with that now with a restaurant where the other restaurant people are writing bad reviews of this restaurant that just opened. And, you know, they weren't even open yet and they were getting reviews. So, you know, I don't know.
What's your success with that? Because I've had to deal with that too.
With Google?
Google, Facebook.
Yeah, well, Facebook, it's rough. And I have had people that just took their reviews down because of that. But Google, actually, they'll respond if you file a grievance. You can say that this is fake, or you can, you know, target some of those, and they'll take them down if they agree with you. Now, sometimes they don't, so. But I think going back to the Yelp thing, I feel like, maybe just ignore them and then move on to someplace else that, you know, will actually be honest about the review process. I believe eventually that's going to catch up to them, because there's been, for a couple of years now, people have been complaining about them and about how they structure those reviews. So that might be why people are ignoring them.
I had a client with one bad review, so they're trying to get good reviews on the other area, and they can't even do that.
Yeah. Oh, sure.
Hurting their business. And so
right.
I'm just curious if you had any issue, any tips or tricks about how to get, you know, reviews to stay on the Yelp. I think I have any experience with that.
Yeah, sorry, I don't. Wish I did, though, but.
What I've done is I drown the Yelp review, you know?
Yeah,
if
he's.
If you don't have enough, Yelp will come out on the first page, but if you drown in other reviews of other places, sometimes it's not as visible.
Yeah, Google will, or Yelp will go down in the listings. You know, if you do focus on, like Rachel said, focus on other review sites. And yeah, I think Google Local is probably one of the better ones where you can get a lot more visibility. Did you? Oh, sure. Yeah, I really think that having a review plugin or something like that, having reviews on your website is a good idea. Google seems to be ranking those too. I can't remember how it goes. If they're within your website and they're a review, they rank your website even a little bit higher. There's something in the local listings services about that. If somebody on Yelp puts a review out, your website will be a little bit higher just because it's coming from you.
Yeah.
And it's coming from your own customers. Okay. Makes sense. Did you have something?
You kind of answered it. Will it help boost you up if you just have a presence on some of these review sites?
Yes, yes, yes. And it's nice if you can go and claim those listings, because the more places, the more citations you have, they call them NAPS, name, address, phone numbers, the more places you have, the higher your website's going to rank if they all match. We've had good luck with that, doing things with building the website and then doing local listings. Name, address, and phone number matches all the citations, then your website ranks higher. Now the reviews are fun on websites because those rank a little bit higher as well. I think I'm out of time, but I'm going to go over to the happiness bar. So if anybody wants to come and chit-chat, let me know. Thanks.